So let's start. So today I'm starting chapter 5. I put some note on announcement in Canvas last Friday. If you have read how we can use the M1, V1 by a number is equal to M2, V2 by another number to do the calculation in titration. Yeah, if you read that. So let's start chapter 5. So chapter 5 is about thermodynamics. So thermodynamics, thermodynamics. So thermodynamics. So thermo means it's related to heat, and dynamics means flow. So heat flow. So in this chapter, we are talking about the flow of heat from one thing to another. Make sense? So thermodynamics means flow of heat, study of flow of heat. So let's take an example here. So this is my oven. So in oven we have this one. So it's hot. So I put some water in this oven here. So maybe I can put a lid here. So it's a lid here. What happens? So this is cold. This is cold. If you put the thermometer here, so maybe it's about 25 degrees centigrade, maybe 23 degrees centigrade. So you already measured the temperature of water in the lab, right? So that was about 22 to 23 degrees centigrade when we were doing density experiment, right? So, but this is very hot. So maybe about 300 degrees centigrade, maybe 500 degrees centigrade, I don't know. So I put this 25 degrees centigrade water in 300 degrees centigrade oven. So what happens is heat flows from oven to our the water, but never from water to the oven, right? So heat always flow from high temperature side to low temperature side. Make sense? So it is kind of a ball, or any ball always fall from high altitude toward the low altitude, right? So from high to low. So it's exactly like that. So the heat always flow from high temperature body toward the low temperature body. That's called the second law of thermodynamics. We'll discuss later. So thermodynamics. So here heat is flowing from oven high temperature body to the water cold temperature body. So this study is called thermodynamics. Make sense? So that's it. So what is energy? So energy is anything. It's a capability to work. So if I have a lot of energy, I can talk whole day. But if I don't have that much energy, I can just talk 10 minutes and I got tired. My energy has gone out, right? Or gone out. So energy is a capability to do work. Make sense? So if you have a lot of heat with this water can do a lot of work. So for example, let's say you have in this beaker you have water and you put something here. So if this water is at, let's say, 105 degrees centigrade, so this is giving a lot of vapor out, right? And that vapor can push this lid up. So it's working, can do a lot of work, right? So, but if this water is at 25 degrees centigrade, so this water is not vaporizing, so this really cannot push this lid up. Right? So if you boil the water, there is a lot of energy with that water, so it can push the lid off. So it has more energy. So more energy means the capability to do the work. Right? So this is how our motorbike or car engine works. So what they have is, they have something like this. So they have an engine here. So it's basically, they have a cylinder here, and so they have a piston here. So this is a car engine, our car engine, motorbike engine, or aeroplane engine. So whatever the engine you talk about in our everyday life. So they have a cylinder and they have a piston here like this. They have a piston here. And this is closed like this here. So piston is exactly like how we did in the lab number three. In lab number three, we are just pushing the piston to expand the gas and or increase the pressure, right? So when we are doing the gas experiment, it's like that. So what happened is that, so they put a little bit fuel here in this part. So there are a lot of valves here. So they open this valve and put a fuel, so petrol here. And they want this fuel. And what happens is that this valve is closed. So what happened is this fuel is burned. And when this fuel is burned, this gives a vapor, right? So what does that vapor do? That expand and push that piston down. Yeah. So when we use our piston in series, we have to push ourselves, right? So, but in engine, we put a fuel there and we burn that fuel and the fuel expand, the gas expand and it push that piston down. So what happens is when I burn this fuel here, it expands. So it's tremendously, this gas expand and it start to push this piston down. So it pushed the piston down for us. So like here, so the piston was here, now the piston goes there, right? So as that piston goes down, so there is a, so this is called the linear motion. So then they have some kind of the wheeled axle and they start to rotate and drive the car. Make sense? So this is how the our internal combustion engine works. So that's all about the thermodynamics. Make sense? So you have a small volume at the beginning. Now you burn it and it expands with that heat and becomes a more volume. And that when the volume becomes more, it gives a pressure. And then that that pressure push the piston down and that create the motion in the wheel of the car and it turns. Makes sense? So this is the thermal dynamics. So everything you see here around is all thermodynamics, yeah? All energy that we use in everyday life, whether it's electricity or heat or heat engine or aeroplane, cars, everything is studied in thermodynamics. So before I come here, I used to teach thermodynamics in UW Milwaukee engineering students. So whole semester, there was a course of thermodynamics. So I was teaching all about engine every day. Yeah. So sometimes petrol engine, sometimes another engine, sometimes another engine, something like that. So let's stop here. So kinetic energy. So we need to understand some of that term here. So what is kinetic energy? So kinetic energy. So kinetic energy. So if something is moving, the energy possessed by that body is called kinetic energy. Make sense? So if something is not moving, that's not that guy doesn't have kinetic energy. But if something is moving, that has kinetic energy. So all of you are sitting there, so you are not changing your position, so you don't have kinetic energy now. So all of you have potential energy. But I am moving, so if I am changing my position from one place to another place, so I have the kinetic energy. Yeah. So kinetic energy is given by mass multiplied by velocity squared divided by 2. So this equation gives the kinetic energy of body. So m is the mass in kg kilogram, and v is the velocity. So suppose there is a ball, let's say there is a ball, somebody hit this ball this way. So let's say mass of this body is 2 kilograms, and when somebody hit this ball, and that moves with, let's say, 5 meters per second velocity. So what is the energy possessed by this moving body can be calculated by this equation, by this. So m is 2 kg, and v is 5 square there and divided by 2. So that is 5 multiplied by 5 is 25, 50 divided by 2. 50 divided by 2 is 25 joule of energy that ball has. Make sense? The kinetic energy is calculated by mv squared by 2. All energy is same energy. Sometimes there's heat energy. So the heat energy pushed the car ahead, right? Now that heat energy converted to the kinetic energy. So energy means all kind of energy is the same energy, but only we are changing the form. So sometimes they have kinetic energy form, sometimes that kinetic energy is converted to the heat energy form, something like that. So so that's called so kinetic energy. So for example, we talked in the first chapter, let's say we have water here. So we have water here. So if these molecules are moving faster, they have higher kinetic energy, right? Because kinetic energy of each particle can be calculated as KE is equals to mv squared by 2. So m is the mass of this molecule. So the one particle, v is the how fast this molecule is moving this way or this way, like randomly. So that's the velocity here. So thermal energy is also a kinetic energy. Thermal motion of particle, what it is saying that motion of the particle energy, so mechanical energy like automobile, electrical energy, that's movement of electron through a conductor, sound energy, this all kind of the energy are the kinetic energy. So for example, so let's say this is a wire and I'm connecting this wire in the plug, so the electrons are moving this way to our television here, right? So this is electricity. So electricity is also the kinetic energy because the electron are moving. Make sense? So heat energy is also kinetic energy. Why? Because the so there are particles here. So if this particle are not moving and all are settling at the bottom like that, so they don't really have a kinetic energy. Make sense? So that's the only possible at -273°C. But if this particle are moving, they definitely have some kinetic energy. So the faster they move, the more kinetic energy they have, right? And that's for the thermal energy. So you already did a homework in chapter one. So if the particle are moving faster, they have higher thermal energy. Or for example, I put a problem like that. So there is a water at, let's say, 30 degrees centigrade, and there is another water, let's say at 80 degrees centigrade. So which has higher thermal energy or the kinetic energy, the molecule higher? So B these guys are moving faster, right? So at higher temperature, the molecules are moving faster. That's why they have more energy there. So like that. What else we have here? The thermal energy, mechanical energy. So definitely mechanical energy means the automobile when it's moving. So that is the kinetic energy, right? So what is the energy of a car? That is, let's say, 500 kilogram, and that is moving with 3600 mile per hour or something like that. I don't know. So you have the kg here. So this mile per hour you need to convert into meter per second, and you multiply mv square divided by 2, and then you get the kinetic energy of the car, right? Correct. So, right. So that's kinetic energy. Now, the another energy we have is the sound energy, also the kinetic energy. So when I'm speaking, so the molecules of the air are being disturbed here. So the molecules just move, disturbing and disturbing your ear, and you hear the sound, right? So sound energy is also the kinetic energy, because it travels by disturbing the molecules of the air. So if there is no air in this room, if we are in the vacuum, you cannot hear I'm talking, yeah? So I talk here, but nobody can listen what I am talking, because the medium is necessary to travel the sound, yeah? So potential energy. So this is potential energy is something when a body is not moving, it is at rest. So how much energy it has, we call that is the potential energy. Something is not moving. So for example, this cluster is here. This cluster is here. So this is not moving. So what kind of energy this has is the potential energy. Make sense? So if it is not moving, and the energy contained by that object is a potential energy. So potential energy. So if a body is at rest, it's not moving, and the energy possessed by that body is called potential energy. And potential energy is given, calculated by this. I didn't write the formula there. So how much energy, potential energy this cluster has here can be calculated by this formula. So M is the mass of this cluster, and G is the acceleration due to gravity, which is 9.8 meter per second. And height is the height of this cluster from the ground. So from down, I just measure from there to this height, and how much height is there. So put it the number there, and this gives the potential energy of the cluster. Make sense? So I can imagine, I can calculate this potential energy in this cluster. So probably this is about 150 gram, right? Probably it's about 150 gram. So let's put that 150 gram, which is 0.150 kg. So 150 gram, the mass is 150 gram, which is divided by 1000, and that's about this much kg. And G is 9.8, acceleration due to gravity. Here is 9.8, that's constant value. And then F, so probably from there to there is about maybe, I don't know, 30, 60, maybe 100 centimeter. Yeah, maybe about 100 centimeters. So we need to convert that into meter. So centimeter to meter would be millimeter, centimeter to meter. So it's about 100. So that's, if that's 100, that's about 0.1 meter. So if you calculate this number, so whatever the value of energy comes here, that much bill of energy in this cluster now. Make sense? So if you know the mass of the object in kilogram, and acceleration due to gravity in any place most of the time is 9.8, and height from the ground to there, if you know that, and put those number in, whatever the value comes there, that's called the potential energy. Make sense? So we need to just identify this different kind of energy here. So the potential energy is energy associated with the position. Position means it's not moving. So something at a certain position and sitting there, and how much energy it has due to its position there is the potential energy. Suppose it is more staying here. So its height is more from ground to here. So it has more potential energy because height is more, right? height is not 0.1, maybe that's a 2 meter or something, 1 meter. So if somebody is living in a very high, something is in a very high height, that has a high potential energy. So chemical energy, is also potential energy. So for example, how can we work every day? Because we eat food, and that food is digested in our body, and that energy helps us to do the work. So that's the potential energy, as a kind of chemical energy. Yeah. So there is a glucose. So everything we eat, like either most of the time the rice or whatever, C6H12O6. So it is decomposed into glucose, C6H12O6. And so these guys have this bone. So energy is stored in this bone. When these bones are broken down, and they release those energy and give us to do the work. Yeah. So all chemical energy are stored in the chemical bone. Make sense? So for example, you are doing the zinc iodine reaction, and so zinc plus iodine, and when you put the zinc and iodine together and you started to shake, and it was hot, right? It become warm. So where does that heat energy come from? So that heat energy was come from here. So when you form the zinc iodine bone like this. So there is the zinc and iodine like that. This bone are forming, and this bone are breaking. I and I bone are breaking. So this give a lot of energy out when the bone is formed. Make sense? So some bone are breaking, some bone are forming. So when you subtract from the bone forming to bone breaking energy, and you get some kind of the heat output. Make sense? So that's the chemical energy. So what is the chemical energy? Chemical energy is the energy stored in the bones of chemicals. Yeah, bone means this bone. So this bone, there is energy in this bone. For example, so C, let's write the CH3CS3. So this is a fuel. So it's a kind of fuel. So if I burn it, it gives a lot of heat out. So where does the heat, that heat comes out? Is because there are CH bond. CF and CC bone like this. So these bones, so these bones holds a lot of energy. So if I burn it, so these bones start to break and they release the energy stored there. So that's the chemical energy. Make sense? What is the chemical energy? Chemical energy is the energy stored in the bone of those chemicals. Yeah? So these are the potential energy. Now law of conservation of energy. So I already told you law of conservation of mass. You already know what is the law of conservation of mass. So if you start with a certain amount of mass at the beginning, and the reaction is complete, and at the end you have the same amount of the mass from which you are started the reaction. You started the reaction. So that's called conservation of mass, right? So conservation of energy is also exactly same thing. So conservation of mass. So conservation of mass. We talk mass cannot be destroyed. Mass can't be destroyed or made. Destroyed or created. So we cannot create mass, or we cannot destroy any mass, right? So that's why we have the we balance the chemical reaction. So this is also exactly the same thing. So conservation of energy. Conservation of energy. So conservation of energy is instead of mass, we write the energy. Energy can't be destroyed nor created. So energy, we cannot create the energy, we cannot destroy the energy. Yeah. So we have electric energy here. Did it create this energy? No, we didn't create. It convert some energy to the electric energy, and we brought it here. Yeah. So in electricity is not the energy we created. We converted some amount of the energy from something and bring it here to here. Make sense? So for example, electricity. So look here. So how does we get the electricity? So here is a sun. So this is sun. This is sun here. Right, so sun has tremendous amount of energy, heat energy. Right, now this is earth here, S1 gives the heat to the earth, right? And we have ocean here. So we have ocean here. So the ocean water goes up due to the heat from the sun, right? So did we create the kinetic energy in this molecule here? No, we did not. So the energy is basically coming from the sun. So sun gives the energy to the earth, and there is a water here. So water gets evaporated, and water goes up here, and that this water goes up here, and it becomes cloud, and comes into rain down here, and then we collect that rain at certain pond or well there, and we allow it to flow in certain pipe, and we put some magnet, electric magnet, like let's say the magnet, maybe you know from the high school physics, right? How we create the electricity, right? And then we have some wire here, and the electricity is get produced here, and it comes to our home. So did we create the electricity here? Did we create the electric energy? No, we did not create the electric energy, right? We convert the electric energy, some kind of the energy, to the electric energy. So basically, the sun gave us heat. That heat is converted to the kinetic energy of this water, and the molecules get evaporated. They go to the cloud and they come down here. So this has the water here is the potential energy because it's not moving. Now we allow this to flow in this pipe, so it has kinetic energy. And this water starts to rotate this magnet here, so it has kinetic energy now. So when the magnet is rotated, the electricity is induced here. So we get the electricity there, and we get this electricity to home and connect with the bulb, and we get the light energy, we connect that to the TV, we get the other kind of energy with the heat. When we connect the heater, we get the heat energy, right? So nothing we are creating, we are just changing one kind of energy to another kind of energy. Make sense? And also we are not destroying electric energy. So we might think that, oh, we are wasting a lot of electric energy, but we really cannot waste the electric energy. We are converting that waste in. So probably if you are connecting this energy to the electricity with this bulb, so you might think that, oh, I'm wasting a lot of light, the electric energy, the heat here. But we didn't waste there. We just converted that to the heat. We wanted to convert that to the more to the light, but we could not convert all that is there to the light. We some of the energy is lost to the heat. Yeah. So it's not really we are destroying energy. We are just converting one kind of the energy to another kind of energy. Yeah. So nobody can create energy. Nobody can destroy energy. Yeah. We just can convert one kind of energy to another kind of energy. So that's for the law of conservation of the energy. So energy can neither be created nor it can be destroyed. It can be converted from one form to another form. The total energy of the universe is always constant. Yeah. So how much energy is it in the universe there? That's always that much energy is there. Yeah. So it cannot be destroyed or increased. Can be decreased or increased. So that's called the law of conservation of energy. So we already talked about this one. So thermal energy. So kinetic energy of the molecule. So what is the thermal energy? So if the molecules of the water or the molecules of the material are moving faster, they have the more energy, right? If the molecules are moving slower, they have the less kinetic energy. So that's called the thermal energy. If temperature is higher, thermal energy is higher, right? Why? Because, for example, we have water is 100 degrees centigrade. If that is the case, the molecules are moving too fast, so they have higher energy. Thermal energy is higher, moving faster. Yeah. So if the temperature is low, the molecules are not moving fast. So if the molecules are moving slow, they have the less kinetic energy, meaning that less thermal energy. Yeah. So basically, the kinetic energy of the molecule is the thermal energy or the heat energy. Yeah. So chemical energy. So potential energy associated with the arrangement of the particles. So I already told you. So what is the chemical energy? So for example, if four particles are associated like this, they have tremendous amount of the energy. But if somehow I bond this one and make carbon dioxide and water, so this has really less amount of energy. This also has less amount of energy. So if I bond this guy here, so this the particle, one particle, two, three, four, five particles here are arranged in such a way that they have tremendous amount of energy. So if I bond that by giving a small amount of fire, they give, they release a lot of that energy out, and we feel the hot. Yeah, make sense. So the the chemical energy is basically the energy stored in the bonds of the chemical. Yeah, bonds means this bonds. So one bond, two bond, three bond, four bond. So there is tremendous amount of energy stored in this bonds, but there is not much energy stored in the bonds of this one. Yeah, make sense like that. So that is called the calorific value of the fuel. So if you look the Coca-Cola bottle, they write, oh, this guy has 160 calories. Yeah, because they have a lot of sugar there. But if they have zero sugar, meaning that something that cannot be digested in body, so that doesn't give any energy to the body. So zero calorie. Yeah. So zero calorie means that that cannot be digested in body to release the energy. Yeah. So like that. So extensive and intensive property. So extensive. So extensive meaning that something that depends on mass. So so let's see here. What is extensive energy or extensive property? So extensive means extensive. Something that depends on mass. So something that depends on mass is called extensive property. Any property that depends on mass is called extensive property. And something that does not depend on mass is called intensive property. So intensive property does not depend on mass. So let's look something. Extensive property. So let's look the kinetic energy. Kinetic energy. What is the kinetic energy formula? Half mv square. So does it depend on mass? Of course, it depends on mass. If you have a bigger mass, this is going to give you a large value, right? Make sense? So kinetic energy is an extensive property. It depends on mass. Yeah. So is potential energy is an extensive property? Let's look it here. Potential energy is equals to mgf. It depends on mass. So if you have a small mass here, you have a whole number is a small number, right? If you have a big mass here, you have a bigger number you will get in calculus, right? So the kinetic energy, potential energy, that's a extensive property because they depend on the mass here. So let's look the what we have here. That's a mass. So volume. Let's look the volume. So volume. So let's take 1 kg water. 1 kg water has a really large volume here, right? So if you have a 1 gram water, you have a small volume here, right? So if you have a small mass, you have a small volume. If you have a big mass, you have a big volume. Does it depend on mass? Yes, it depends on mass, right? Make sense? So if you take a smaller amount of maybe 2 gram of water, so 2 gram of water and put it here, very small volume, right? But if you take 2 kilogram of water or 5 kilogram of water, it takes large volume, right? So if the mass is more, volume is more. If the mass is small, volume is small, right? So that's an extensive property. Make sense? So mass itself is an extensive property. Volume is extensive property, and I just show you energy is extensive property. Kinetic energy is depending on mass. Potential energy is also depending on the mass. So any kind of energy is depending on mass. So if you look the other kind of the energy in physics book, they write like this: E is equals to mc square. Does this energy depend on mass? Yes. So if you have a more mass, you have large energy, right? So if you put 2 here, 2 kg here, 2 c square. If you put 5 here, 5 c square. If the mass is more, energy is more, right? It depends on mass. Make sense? So, like that. So let's talk intensive energy. So intensive energy does not depend on mass. So You already know intensive energy, like density. So density does not depend on mass. So density is an intensive property. So how density is an intensive property is like this. So take some, this is a cylinder. So let's say you take here 15 ml of water, right? 15 ml of water, just like how we did in the lab number one, right? So 15 ml of water, this is the volume. So this is volume. Now measure the mass of this one. So that is about 15 grams, approximately 15 grams. So this is mass, this is volume. So get the density. So 15 divided by 15, you get about, so this is the mass divided by volume is 15, about 1 gram per ml. See that? 20. Now, like this one. Now, if you take a very small amount of water, so you are doing three times, so maybe another time you take about 10 ml of water, 10 ml of water, and measure the mass of this water, that comes about 10 gram, in density is equal to mass divided by volume, so 10 by 10, again gives 1. Make sense? So when you are taking some ratios, so that extensive property quality just disappears, and it starts to become the intensive property. Make sense? When we are taking the ratio, so here I'm taking the ratio of mass to volume, so that just takes away that extensive quality. So the density of water, no matter where we go, is 1 gram per ml. So if you do the take a little bit water and measure the density in the lab here, and that you get 1 gram per ml. And you go to the very, very big lake here and put your density meter here, and it also gives 1 gram per ml. Yeah. So no matter where you go and measure how big is the lake, so density of water is always the same due to that ratio of m divided by v. Make sense? So like that. So this is one. So I told you these three things are mass, volume, and mass, volume, and energy. These three things are also area. Also, so if there is, so if you have a bigger mass, that's a bigger area, right? So bigger thing. So this is a smaller thing. This is a bigger thing, right? So bigger thing has bigger area. Yeah, if we calculate the area. So these things are extensive property, meaning that if you have a more mass, that has more volume, that has more energy, that has more area, something like that. Yeah, so they are extensive property. Make sense? Now, if you see anything in front of this guy, so specific, look the word specific volume, specific mass, specific volume, specific energy, specific area. So if you see anything that write specific in front of those extensive property, they immediately become intensive property. Make sense? Specific means the ratio. So density. So let's talk about the density. So density is a density. What is density? Density is mass divided by volume. So it's a ratio. So this is a specific mass. So mass divided by volume, we call specific mass. So specific mass is called density. The mass for certain amount of volume, meaning specific. So if you see specific word in front of extensive property, they become intensive property. That ratio makes them the intensive, independent of the mass. Make sense? Good. So specific. When you see the specific mass, specific volume, specific energy, specific area, so they are intensive energy. So let's look here. So let's say you have a 5 liter or 5 gallon, 5 gallon petrol. So you put a 5 gallon petrol in a car. So 5 gallon has one time, another time maybe you put 2 gallon petrol in car. So 5 gallon definitely has a large amount of energy, right? You can drive longer distance with 5 gallon, right? So this has more energy. But 2 gallons, small mass, small volume. So This doesn't have that much energy. So this is the extensive property. Okay? Good. Now, if you start to convert this into the energy, so 1 gallon of each have maybe, let's say 2000 kilojoule of energy or something like that. So that means a gallon per kg. So if you put it down here, 1 gallon, it kg down here, like this. So that is 2000. So 1 gallon per kg. It's a kind of the ratio. So 1 gallon. So I'm just reducing it to the 1 gallon now, right? So it doesn't matter. Either you put 5 gallon or 2 gallon or 1 gallon. So 1 gallon of petrol always has the same amount of energy, right? Yes, sir? So 5 gallon of petrol might give you 10 to the power 5 kilojoules here. But and 1 gallon would give us let's say 100 kilojoules here. So if 5 gallon petrol gives 100 kilojoules, 1 gallon would give us 20 kilojoules, right? So here, so 2 gallon here would give me how much? So if 5 gallon gives 100, 1 gallon would give me 10, right? No, 1 gallon would give me 20, and 2 gallon would give me 40 kilojoules, right? And from here also, 1 gallon I would give 20 kilojoules. See that? That's a I just reduced everything to in terms of one gallon, right? So something like that. So specific energy means how much I get out of one of something, 1 gallon. Yeah. So that's specific. So how much energy I get out of 1 gram of glucose. So you can read the calorie value of food or fuel. So how much energy I can get out from 1 gram of glucose? Maybe 50 joule. So this is specific energy. Why? I'm just taking 1 gram. Yeah. So 1 gram of glucose, no matter where I go, gives the 50 joule of energy. Yeah. Make sense? So that's what it becomes the intensive property. So when I just take 1 gram of anything and try to measure the energy like that, it's always the same. So we call that as an intensive energy. All right, so basically, why intensive energy? Why specific energy, the intensive energy? Because when I take the ratio, it always gives the same number, yeah? So for example, in case of the density of water, if you take 10 kg of air and measure the volume, that comes about the 10 liter, and that is equal to 1 gram per ml or 1 kg per ml. So because of that ratio, the extensive property just disappeared. Yeah. So anything you see specific in the specific area, specific mass, anything you see specific in front of anything, you immediately should write it's an intensive property. Make sense? So like that. So heat versus temperature. So a lot of us may think that, oh, something is hot, so it has more energy. It's not true. So heat versus the temperature. So heat is a real cause. Yeah. So heat is the real thing we need. So temperature is something, it's effect only. Yeah. So heat and heat versus temperature. Temperature. So let's say I have 50 kg water here with 5 degree centigrade, and I have let's say 1 kg water here water here with 100 degrees centigrade. So which has more energy? So it looks like 100 degrees centigrade. So if you think that, oh, that's a high temperature, so it has a lot of energy. Not really. So yeah, this has 50 kg. So it's a, when you have a large mass, they have large energy. Yeah. So energy. So with 1 kg water, we ideally can't do anything. But with 50 kg water, we can do a lot of things, right? So you can easily guess. So if you throw this water, it can really run a very big engine, 50 kg water, right? So it has a lot of energy. But if you run this 1 kg water, it really cannot run a big engine, right? Make sense? So energy is the real thing that we are interested in. So temperature is just the effect of the heat. Yeah. So heat is a transfer of energy from hot object to cold object. So so what is the heat? So the definition is not really include everything here. So what is heat energy? Heat energy is basically you have a hot thing here and you have a cold thing here. So this is water, this is heater. So heat is a kind of the form of energy. It flows from the hot object to a colder object. So anything that is flowing from hot object to the colder object is called the heat energy. Yeah. So what does flow there? It's a heat flow there, right? So if I contact the cold object with the hot object, so something flows from the hot object to the cold object, and that is called the heat energy. Yeah. So that's how they define the heat. So and it is an extensive property. You already know that energy is an extensive property. You can just write that potential energy equals to mgf, kinetic energy equals to mv square by 2, and just like that, the heat energy is also the extensive property. So heat energy is given by this equation. So Q, so Q is a heat, so heat energy, Q is a heat energy, and it is given by m is a mass, and s is a specific capacity, we will talk later, and T2 minus T1, so by this equation, look here, so this is a heat energy, there is a mass term, right? So heat energy is an extensive property. Why? It depends on the mass. Make sense? So if you have a more mass, it has a more heat energy. If you have a small mass, it has less heat energy. Make sense? Okay. Heat is extensive property. It depends on the mass. And a dam of water has higher energy than a cup of water, definitely, right? Look here. So a cup of water is this one, and a dam of water is this one. So a lot of mass here. So use that formula there. Q is equals to ms T2 minus T1. So this has a cup of water might have half kg of water. So 0.5 kg, and put all this value, and you get some energy value there. But a gram of water might have thousands of kilograms of water. So heat energy is there in ms T2 minus T1. So if you put the 1000 kg here, so immediately you can see that the heat energy with the more mass object has a more heat energy. Make sense? Have you got that? So let's look that formula. Heat energy is always equals to heat energy, and it depends on mass. So if you have a bigger mass, that has a high amount of heat energy. Yeah? So temperature, what is temperature? Temperature is a degree of hotness or coldness. Temperature is intensive property, it varies independent of mass. So thermometer, so put the so take a bit of water here. So let's say you have a water and it's boiling water, and put that water or a small amount of water in this cup and a bigger amount of water in this cup and put thermometer. So put on thermometer here. So if it is boiling, this is also 100 degrees centigrade, this is also 100 degrees centigrade, this is also 100 degrees centigrade. So whether the boiling water is either a big amount or a small amount or a tiny amount, it doesn't matter. The temperature of water is always the same, independent of the mass, right? Make sense? So put a big amount of water in oven here. So this is oven, put a big amount of water here and start to boil it. And when it boils, you will see the 100 degrees centigrade here. So put again a small amount of water here and boil it, put the thermometer here. When you start to boil it, it's also 100 degrees centigrade. So the temperature is independent of mass. Make sense? So the boiling water, I believe it's boil one cup of tea or 50 cups of tea. So put the thermometer, when they start to boil, the temperature is same, 100 degrees centigrade. Yeah, so this is a intensive process. Yeah, so temperature is independent of mass, but it is dependent on mass. So it's more mass, more energy. But temperature does not depend on mass. Yeah, so. So here is an example, a drop of boiling water that is 100 degrees centigrade versus a pot of boiling water that's also 100 degrees centigrade. Both have the same temperature but different heat content. So different heat content means, so let's say, which has a large amount of heat there. So let's say this is a drop of water and this is a pot of water. So both are boiling here, so put thermometer 100 degrees centigrade here, put thermometer here. 100 degrees centigrade here. So both have same temperature, but which has a more heat energy? Definitely this one, because heat energy is equal to ms T2 minus T1. So mass is large number here, so a lot of energy here, but the mass here is small. So when you put the small mass here, this gives small number here. Make sense? Have you got that? So if you have a small amount of material, that has a small amount of the heat energy, but if you have a large amount of the material, that has more energy. Yeah, more is better. Now, a drop has 0.1 joule, and a pot of boiling water has 1000 kilojoule. Even if both are at same temperature, 100 degrees centigrade, a drop of water at 100 degrees centigrade has 0.1 joule, and a pot of boiling water might have 1000 kilojoule. Right? So definitely, a pot of boiling water that can do a lot of work compared to a drop of boiling water, right? So a pot of boiling water basically can throw its the lid of the vessel, right? When it's boiling, but a drop cannot do anything. So who has more energy? A drop or a pot? A pot of water has more energy, right? All right. So I think that all covered the basic things for we have here today. Thank you.